Hello everyone. In this video, we'll be going through a brief introduction and overview of upper limb. The upper limb is the organ of the body responsible for manual activities. It is freely movable, especially at its distal segment, which is the hand, and is adapted for grasping and manipulating the objects. A brief description of comparative anatomy of the limbs would facilitate understanding of their structure and function. All of the terrestrial vertebrates possesses four limbs, a pair of forelimbs and a pair of hind limbs. In quadrupeds such as dogs and buffaloes, both the forelimbs and hind limbs are evolved for transmission of body weight and locomotion. In human beings, due to evolution of erect posture, the function of weight bearing and locomotion is performed only by the hind limbs or the lower limbs, while upper limbs are spared for prehensile or manipulative activities such as grasping, holding, picking and similar activities. There are three types of grips: the power grip, the hook grip and the precision grip. The power grip and hook grips are primitive in nature, hence found in their higher primates. The precision grip is characteristic of human beings, hence only humans can properly hold a pen, pencil, needles, instruments and similar objects. As a result, human beings could make advancements in arts, crafts, technology and of course with the help of intelligence. To suit these prehensile activities, there are many changes that took place in the upper limb of humans during evolution. One such is appearance of hands permitting rotatory movements of forearm like supination and pronation, addition of clavicle to act as a strut and keep upper limb away from the body for prehension, and rotation of thumb to 90 degrees for apposition, and finally suitable changes for free mobility of fingers and hands. All these changes together, they have made these prehensile activities possible for human beings. The upper limbs are connected to the trunk by pectoral girdle. The limb girdle is defined as bones which connect the limbs to the axial skeleton. The pectoral girdle is composed of two bones, the scapula and the clavicle. The scapula is connected to the clavicle by acromioclavicular joint, and the clavicle is attached to the axial skeleton by the sternoclavicular joint. The pectoral girdle is not a complete girdle because it is attached to the axial skeleton only anteriorly. The primary function of the pectoral girdle is to provide attachment to numerous muscles which move the arm and forearm. It is not a weight bearing and therefore more delicate as compared to the pelvic girdle. In contrast, the pelvic girdle is a complete girdle. Just remember that only one small joint, that is the sternoclavicular joint, connects the skeleton of upper limb to the rest of the skeleton of the body. For descriptive purposes, the upper limb is divided into four parts: shoulder, arm or brachium, forearm or antebrachium, and hand. The shoulder region includes axilla or armpit, scapular region or parts around the scapula or the shoulder blade, and pectoral or breast region on the front of the chest. The bones of shoulder region are the clavicle and the scapula. They articulate with each other at the acromioclavicular joint and form the shoulder girdle. The shoulder girdle articulates with the rest of the skeleton of the body only at the small sternoclavicular joint. The arm is the part of the upper limb between the shoulder and elbow or cubitus. The bone of the arm is humerus, which articulates with the scapula at the shoulder joint and upper ends of radius and ulna at the elbow joint. The forearm is the part of upper limb between the elbow and the wrist joint. The bones of the forearm are radius and ulna. These bones articulate with humerus at the elbow joint and with each other, forming radioulnar joints. The hand, also called mannus, consists of the wrist or carpus, the hand proper or metacarpus, and the digits, which includes thumbs and fingers. The wrist consists of 8 carpal bones arranged in 2 rows, each consisting of 4 bones. The carpal bones articulate with each other at the intercarpal joints, proximally with the radius forming the radiocarpal or the wrist joint, and distally with the metacarpal bones at carpometacarpal joints. The hand proper consists of 5 metacarpal bones numbered 1 to 5 from lateral to medial side in anatomical position. They articulate proximally with distal row of carpal bones forming the carpometacarpal joints, with each other forming intermetacarpal joints, and distally with the proximal phalanges forming the metacarpophalangeal joints. The digits are 5 and numbered 1 to 5 from lateral to medial side in the anatomical position. The first digit is the thumb and remaining 4 digits are fingers. Each digit is supported by 3 short long bones, the phalanges, except thumb, which is supported only by 2 phalanges. The phalanges form metacarpophalangeal joint with metacarpals and interphalangeal joints with each other. The first carpometacarpal joint has a separate joint cavity, hence movements of thumb are much more free than that of other digits or fingers. Both the upper and lower limbs are built on the same basic principle. Each limb is made up of 2 portions, proximal part and the distal part. The proximal part is called limb girdle and attaches the limb to the trunk. The distal part is free and consists of proximal, middle and distal segments, which are referred to arm, forearm and hand in the upper limb, thigh, leg and foot respectively in the lower limb. The homologous parts of upper and lower limbs are shoulder girdle is equivalent to hip girdle in the lower limb. The shoulder joint is equivalent to hip joint. Arm in the upper limb is equivalent to thigh. The elbow joint is equivalent to knee joint. Forearm is equivalent to leg in lower limb. Wrist joint is equivalent to ankle joint. And in the hand, the carpus is equal to tarsus. The metacarpus is equal to metatarsus, and fingers and toes are similar. So in the upper limb, the first digit of hand is termed as thumb, and in foot, the similarly first digit is termed as great. The development of upper and lower limbs begins in the 4th week of intrauterine life. A pair of small elevations appear on the ventrolateral aspect of the embryo called the limb buds. The anterior pair of upper limb buds appear opposite the lower cervical segments. The posterior pair of lower limb buds appear 3 to 4 days later at the level of lumbar and upper sacral segments. Thus, during early development stage, all 4 limbs appear as paired limb buds. First, they are simpler, flipper-like appendages, so that the upper and lower limbs are similar in their appearance. Each has dorsal and ventral surfaces and preaxial and postaxial borders. The preaxial border faces towards the head. Later in the development, the ends of limb buds become expanded and flattened to form the hand and foot plates in which the digits develop. The digits nearest to the preaxial border are thumb and big toe in the upper and lower limbs respectively. The limbs then rotate. The lower limb buds rotate medially through 90 degrees so that their preaxial border faces medially and their extensor surface faces forward. The upper limb buds, on the other hand, rotate laterally through 90 degrees so that their preaxial border faces laterally and their extensor surface faces backward. There are important differences between upper and lower limb that can be summarized as: the function of upper limb is predominantly prehension, that is manipulation of objects by grasping, while lower limb is designed for locomotion and transmission of weight. Bones of upper limb are smaller and weaker, whereas those of lower limb are larger and stronger. Joints of upper limb are smaller and less stable, while those of lower limbs are larger and more stable. Muscles also in upper limb, they are smaller and attached to smaller bony areas, and anti-gravity muscles are less developed. Whereas in lower limb, these muscles are larger and attached to larger bony areas, and anti-gravity muscles are more developed as they are designed to bear weight. The girdle of the upper limb is the pectoral girdle and made up of two bones, that is by scapula and clavicle. There is no articulation with the vertebral column, and articulation with the axial skeleton is at very small through the sternoclavicular joint. Whereas the pelvic girdle of lower limb is made up of a single bone called the hip bone, and it articulates with the vertebral column. Articulation is with the axial skeleton is large through the sacroiliac joint. The preaxial border of upper limb faces laterally, whereas the preaxial border of lower limb faces medially. The force that is exerted on the hand through the wrist joint passes through to the radius, and through the interosseous membrane this force is transmitted to ulna, and through the elbow joint the force is transmitted to humerus, and through the shoulder joint to scapula, and through coracoclavicular ligament this force is transmitted to clavicle, and through sternoclavicular and costoclavicular ligament this force is transmitted to axial skeleton. This way the forces are transmitted from distal to the proximal end in the upper limb. The bones of upper limb will be discussed in the separate video. And as discussed, the muscles of upper limb include muscles that attach the limb to the girdle to the body, and muscles of arm, forearm and the hand. The deltoid muscle covers the shoulder like a hood and is commonly used for intramuscular injections. The arm and forearm are invested in the deep fascia like a sleeve, and are divided into anterior and posterior compartments by intermuscular septa. The muscles of anterior and posterior compartments mainly act synergistically to carry out specific functions. The muscles of anterior compartment are mainly the flexors, and those of posterior compartment are predominantly extensors. The muscles of hand are responsible for its various skilled movements such as grasping, etc. The nerve supply to the upper limb is derived from the brachial plexus formed by ventral rami of C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1 spinal nerves. The five main branches of brachial plexus are the axillary nerve, the musculocutaneous nerve, the median nerve, the ulnar nerve and the radial nerves. The axillary nerve supplies the deltoid and teres minor muscles. The musculocutaneous, median and ulnar nerves supply the muscles of anterior or flexor compartment of the arm and forearm. The radial nerve supplies the muscles of posterior or extensor compartment of the forearm. Kindly note that all the intrinsic muscles of the hand are supplied by the ulnar nerve except the muscles of thina remnans and first two lumbricals. The blood supply to the upper limb is by four main arteries: the axillary artery, the brachial artery, the radial artery and the ulnar artery. The axillary artery is continuation of subclavian artery. At the lower border of the teres major muscle, its name is changed to brachial artery. The brachial artery continues down the arm, and just distal to the elbow joint it divides into radial and ulnar arteries, which follow the bones, after which they are named. In the hand, the radial artery terminates by forming the deep palmar arch and ulnar artery terminates by forming the superficial palmar arch. The axillary artery supplies the shoulder region. The brachial artery supplies the anterior and posterior compartments of the arm. The radial and ulnar arteries supply the lateral and medial parts of forearm respectively. The deep pins of upper limb follow the arteries and run superiorly towards the axilla, where axillary vein travels superiorly and becomes subclavian vein at the outer border of the first rib. The subclavian vein continues towards the root of the neck, where it joins the internal jugular vein to form the brachiocephalic vein. The two brachiocephalic veins, that is each from right and left, join each other to form superior vena cava, which drains into the heart. The superficial veins of the upper limb originate from the dorsal venous arch of the hand. The lateral end of the dorsal venous arch forms the cephalic vein, which runs along the lateral aspect of upper limb and terminates into the axillary vein at the axilla. The medial end of the dorsal venous arch forms the basilic vein, which ascends along the medial aspect of upper limb and empties into the axillary vein as well. Anterior to the elbow, the cephalic vein is connected to the basilic vein via the median cubital vein.